Okay, it's time to start. I actually saw like 40 people registered, but probably the other 20 would watch on YouTube later. My name is Nikolay Valchev. I'm from SAP. I'm working for 3 years now in the Cloud Foundry domain, and especially in the lifecycle management part of it. So here I will talk about, first of all, distributed apps in the cloud, what are their challenges, and then would share our experience at SAP, how we actually manage such kind of apps in an easy manner. Okay. Starting with distributed applications in the cloud, what is this beast? Very abstractly speaking, we have this cloud in the middle. You can imagine this is a Cloud Foundry deployment somewhere on whatever IaaS. Normally, we have the end user of your business app, which is accessing it via one unique endpoint or a graphical web user interface. But normally, behind this web application or a service is an interconnected graph of other subcomponents running again in the cloud or in any other cloud, bringing different aspects of this one business capability that the user actually is interested in. Normally, there is this application development team who is responsible for the development, for the testing, for the configuration, updates, etc., of this interconnected set of applications. This team needs to actually manage this this distributed app in the cloud. So what are the challenges that we see for this application? We would start with a very simple example. It is a very common pattern that you, for instance, separate your front end from back end, develop this in the most appropriate technology for the purpose, like doing front end in Node.js that deals from user request processing, or some back end in Java for heavy data processing, etc. These two apps need to evolve together because changes in the backend needs to be accordingly reflected in the UI. So we are talking here for a not that decoupled lifecycle of these apps. These apps have dependencies to a persistent service, like PostgreSQL. The front end here needs some geospatial resource, which is external to our app here, our distributed app, because it is managed by another team. It might be even deployed in another cloud, it'd be whatever. The Java backend might expose some this way stable API for consumption from another service. And all this is managed by our application team. So what are the challenges that we see in practice? First of all, how to develop the different components, possibly heterogeneous, of our distributed app, consistently achieving some versioning between the apps, and common build, test, run workflow. Then how to model deployment-specific configuration, because this is one thing, assembling your apps, but then you want to deploy them at dev, at test, at prod, possibly with different configuration for each of these deployment environments. So these have to be declared somewhere. Then possibly how to package and deliver, because in some cases you don't have to package, you might have some continuous integration that you directly deploy from the source control repository, etc. But at some times you might want to package version, possibly exposed to a marketplace your application to be, for instance, purchased by other users, etc. Then how to deploy it via possibly one single operation, following the concrete order of deployment of these apps, because we would see that this also is important. how to update it without breaking the app, because different services might require, for instance, the UI might require first to update the backend in order to work. Possibly without downtime, there are patterns like blue-green deployment introduced for on the app level. But here we are talking about this distributed set of apps, so we need something on that level in order to achieve true zero downtime update. And finally, how to undeploy all these things with without any leftovers on the system. So what are the solutions that we see in practice? Many teams come up with these script code words actually to automate their lifecycle operations, to create different apps in certain order, to create certain services also in order, to bind them, etc. This is really possible solution, but first of all, it requires significant upfront investment and is kind of costly to maintain in time. And actually, what I'm going to propose and cover here is to offer some declarative app model, which would be interpreted by deployment tooling to actually address all these challenges. We already have this on the app level in Cloud Foundry. You can deploy app with certain configuration, bind it to services, but this doesn't cover your more complex, possibly, solution that has several apps there and possibly managed services. So I'm going to introduce here the multi-target application concept, or simply MTA. And this is, first of all, a spec developed at SAP and a model, declarative model, where application developer teams could actually describe the structure of their distributed app, where the different Cloud Foundry apps are mapped to entities called modules, and the managed services are mapped to entities called resources. So on the left side, we see our application in the Cloud Foundry runtime. Actually, we map it to something declarative here. And the definition here is that this multi-target application, or MTA, is composed of different, possibly heterogeneous apps, possibly different services, that we want to manage as one lifecycle management unit. We want to deploy it, to update it, possibly to do blue-green deployment with it, and finally delete it with one operation. So what such kind of a model could be good for? First of all, define explicitly the structure of our distributed app. In most cases, this is not that explicit. You deploy several apps, they understand their URIs via some other means, etc. But having a declarative model, there could be tools that actually deploy this application automatically. And I will show that. Second, you might declare any external resources that our app depends on, either on deployment or runtime, so that tools could allocate automatically these resources and buy them for you. Even on undeployment, remove these external resources. And here I'm not talking only for managed services in Cloud Foundry, but this could be actually anything there. And the third good thing is to put declaratively the specifics, actually to declare the specifics for your app for deployment in different deployment contexts, like that in dev you want to run with low memory, in queue you want to do some load testing, and on prod to have separate configuration. So having this declaration, actually we can really distinguish between the stable structure of the application and the volatile configuration between the different deployments. Here we can actually provide capabilities like even interactive filling of some missing configuration on deploy time. Okay, so the main challenge actually that we are addressing here, and actually we are addressing with putting one lifecycle around these distributed apps. So what is this lifecycle? We want to cover the development through build and distribution of your app to the operations. So we cover the whole spectrum here. Starting with development, this is not that different from before. And actually, to illustrate, I've taken the prominent Spring Music sample for Cloud Foundry. Actually, it is rather simple. In its classical form, it contains just one Spring application with persistence. But I've extended with it with some news provider that you could manage not only songs and albums in the classical Spring music, but you can also show some music news. I've also added some external news provider that are coming outside from our app. So this is the thing that I as a developer want to manage. First of all, I have to create all sources in your ID of choice, whatever, okay. And then I have to define this structure of my application. And for defining the structure, we use YAML descriptor files, starting with the MTA deployment descriptor, which is the thing that you put your static content of your app, static structure. This is normally included in your Git repository. And you normally have one of it. Then you might add extension descriptors. These are kind of descriptors holding your deployment specifics. And they're merged on your static part. So via such kind of files, you can alter the configuration for dev, for prod, for test, etc. So there might be different extension descriptors, and they come when you deploy the app. It is normally not part of your source control, etc. And is provided by the operator. So this is my enhanced Spring Music deployment descriptor. This is the YAML file, but just to cover the most prominent parts from it, first of all, we're enhancing the standard metadata offered by Cloud Foundry with additional extensions. So we are adding this spec version. As I said, the MTA is a spec. It defines what are the things I could put here in terms of elements, but it is not that important here. What's important is that I give my application, distributed application, an ID so I can correlate the different parts of my app. I also give it a version so I could achieve unified versioning of the different components. Then I define the so-called modules. Remember, these are the apps that would be created in the runtime. These have types which correspond to the different build packs that would be used. But via the type semantic, you can associate additional default configuration for your app. For instance, say that your Java apps need to be run by default with 2 GB of memory. This is something very useful that we see at SAP. Additionally, you add the path to the binaries. Additionally, you can configure other parameters like build pack, routes, memory, instances, etc. Actually, everything that you can put in the standard manifest YAML, you can put it here as well in the parameters of the app. You can also add the environment. This is yet another standard thing. But one prominent addition is that in practice we see that when you decompose your app to different parts, you normally want to do some kind of discovery between your UI and the backend, and there are different ways to achieve it. Spring Cloud provides something for that, but here we provide another alternative. So. We are not opinionated, but we have additional ways so you can expose configuration from one of the apps, which could be read and injected in the environment of other apps. So here my Spring News app exposes its URL so that it is visible for other apps. You can see that we are using here some placeholder notation. And this kind of placeholders with the door would be resolved on deployment time automatically by the deploy tools. So here the default URL would be resolved to whatever URL is assigned to my news application at runtime. Then I actually inject the URL of our news provider in my main web application via such kind of require section, and actually it would be injected in an environment variable called news URL here. I'm doing a reference to it, so that's it. We have URL from one app in the environment of the another that wants to talk to it. Additionally, we add the resources. These are our managed services. We have one Postgres managed service, and we have one user-provided service. Remember, the user-provided service is our external service, this external news provider. We configure them at the service label, in the first case, Postgres, certain plan, and we configure the user-provided service. But something is missing here, actually. It's missing the URL. This is something that is not known on design time of your app. Actually, this URL of this external news provider would come possibly at deployment time and might vary via different deployments of your app. So this is something that I don't want to put here because I simply don't know it. Okay, then we have service bindings. Actually, all of the stuff that is allowed to model for your app, like routes, bindings, etc., all of it is supported here as well. You simply put it in a more declarative way. We might define service bindings with certain parameters for the bindings. And having this static structure filled out, we could prepare also some kind of a deployment-specific configuration. So this is an example of this extension descriptor in which I'm providing certain concrete values for instance, production deployment of my app. So I provide concrete values for memory, for instances, and I also could configure with a concrete URL my external service provider. So this is the extension file that comes on deployment time. Good, I've developed the app, prepared the sources, defined these two descriptor files. One of them is mandatory, the static one, the deployment descriptor, the other is optional. Then I have to build. Actually, this is an optional step. As I said, some people or teams, they develop and deploy directly from source. But if you want to actually package and distribute your app or, as I said, publish it to a marketplace, you might want to package it and bring it to one structure. For that, we introduce the so-called empty archive, which is a kind of container compliant with the jar specification. And it, in essence, contains my application sources. It contains the sources plus the jar manifest and the deployment descriptor. Remember, this is the file containing the structure of our application. And it is normally contained in the archive. So this archive is then used for distribution. I might send it, I might publish it somewhere, etc. I might sign it, so the deployment tools could check the signatures of this archive. So how I build it? Actually, first of all, I start with defining the project structure, sources, etc., and build my sources. Actually, in the Spring web application, I have a jar file and a Node.js application for my news provider. Then I could alter the MTA deployment descriptor via whatever YAML editor I choose. Then could add the manifest YAML for the jar file. This is an optional thing. And could finally use a jar and or a Maven plugin, we have such, for building this structure into an empty archive. This is the thing that we actually distribute to operations then. So we've covered the development, building, right now we're coming to the interesting stuff, to the deploy. Actually, this is where the challenges are experienced here. So we're deploying the app to Cloud Foundry, and for that we introduce the so-called Cloud Foundry deploy service, whose purpose is to actually deploy and automate the lifecycle operations of my distributed app with single operation. and in the same time actually assure the completeness and consistency of our app. So we have the operator using a standard Cloud Foundry terminal here with one additional plugin called CF deploy with this command. And the operator actually hands over here the empty archive plus the deployment specific configuration, which is optional because the archive could be self-contained, could contain anything there. And then this actually calls the so-called Cloud Foundry deploy service backend, whose purpose is to achieve your desired state of your distributed app. It is a standard application running in Cloud Foundry, and in order to bring your app to its desired state, it implements a certain set of predefined workflows. What are essentially these workflows doing? They first of all are analyzing the empty archive plus your deployment specific configuration in terms of extension descriptor. The deploy service is reading the current state from the Cloud Foundry environment, reading directly the Cloud Controller API, comparing these two, and computing the delta between the current and the desired target state, and actually executing only these delta operations. So as a final phase, I would have my desired state of the application. So what are the supported operations that we have? First of all, deployment, which is also incremental. This meaning that you might deploy your app and then update it, and only the updated or changed things would be actually pushed again, restaged, rewired, etc. We support deployment from Git repository, so you might directly put all your stuff in GitHub, just do CF deploy with Git URL, and this would actually materialize your apps and services in the Cloud Foundry runtime. And we also have plans for supporting the deployment directly from sources, from directory. We also have this important thing, Blue Green deployment, but not like the classical Blue Green deployment, but not on app level, but covering these different apps that are interconnected and actually achieve our capability. And we also have a thing called cross application, cross MTA configuration. So I showed you how to actually expose and consume configuration from within your app. But we also provide a kind of configuration mechanism that you can use between different apps here. Some additional, we call it on enterprise qualities that we provide. First of all things are deployed deterministically via concrete ordering, exposed via the deployment descriptor. There is, for instance, a resume from a failure, from multi-step operation, if there is something like that. We implement certain version evolution policies, like you might disallow downgrade of your app. And finally, deletion of not relevant artifacts on update, or when you have just removed one app on update, or the complete undeployment of your app. So this was the kind of boring stuff, some real data. Our services is live on SAP, SAP Cloud Platform Cloud Foundry. There we execute more than 1,000 deploys per day. We have at SAP at least more than 1,500 such kind of distributed apps, including the test ones that are used by different teams, and more than 100 productive applications running in our platform. And this all is actually developed, built optionally, and deployed via this deployment infrastructure. And one important thing, it is open source from the last Friday, so you can find everything on GitHub. First of all, the MTA model guide. We have this MTA plugin for the Cloud Foundry CLI, and our backend or workflow engine that actually deploys your app with a single operation and actually achieves this automation. So you can look at it, we can try it. What are the next steps? So we are open source, but we are also eager to contribute to the community. So we already initiated some talks with, for instance, Dr. Max from the extensions PMC, and we expected to give in the next weeks a proposal for incubation in the Cloud Foundry Foundation. But in the meantime, we are actually continuing our work for actually achieving additional capabilities based on this declarative model that we introduced. Some planned features that we have, a parallel materialization of artifacts that would further reduce the overall deployment time. Application configuration update, so you might not want to actually re-upload via CF push and restate your app, but just some kind of configuration update. We plan support for Docker, and with such kind of support, you might imagine that we would act as a Docker compose for Cloud Foundry. Additional interesting thing is the lifecycle hooks, where you might add some custom application coding executed on different lifecycle phases of your app, like on update or on delete, and additional secure configuration management, like reusing this Cred Hub project that is now right now is getting some hype for our configuration management. So having this outlook, the key takeaways are, first of all, we see a common pattern for the distributed cloud apps in Cloud Foundry. We are coming with the MTA model actually to address these apps and build these processes from development through build to deployment, actually to address them, to bring these enterprise qualities, and we are happy now to contribute to the foundation with that. And yeah, I would really appreciate that you look on this, give your feedback, and really drive further the lifecycle management area in the Cloud Foundry. Thanks. Okay. I didn't get it.
If I'm using the ID to create the manifest the file, the configuration YAML,
yes.
May I get some assistance from plugin or something that could auto-complete the properties?
Yeah, this is a very good question. Right now, in the open source world, there is no support. At SAP, we have certain tooling that we might open source that as well, but anyway, if we are planning to provide some support for that as well, because this is really a missing thing. You might use any YAML editor out in the world, but yeah, the assistance is a thing that we are planning to provide. Okay.
So maybe I didn't catch it. The part where the deployment happens, the workflows, how much influence do I have if I need something more than just the ordering of which app is deployed at which time? Let's say I need to start my migration app in a certain mode, wait until it's done based on a log, for example, and then continue with the deployment. Can I do model workflows?
Yeah. Yeah. This right now is supported to some extent. First of all, you can model declaratively your app. This gives you the possible ordering. There you might. I actually didn't show an example of it because there are many things in the Cloud Foundry like capabilities. But you can model certain Cloud Foundry tasks to be executed as part of your app against the application droplet. So you might model this as well. And with the lifecycle hooks that I mentioned would be possibly the silver bullet for such kind of things, that you might add some migration logic that is executed only on update, or possibly do some cleanup on delete, etc. But anyway, even now, without these capabilities, you might add this in your application coding on Bootstrap, etc. But things like in terms of support are coming for that. And the CF tasks right now are also available. OK. Yeah, this is supported in the BlueGreen deployment that we have. You know, BlueGreen, you deploy both versions and just switch from one to the another. And on MTA, on this level, we support it with the two different apps. We would have two different sets of apps working. So you might test the new version. If you are not satisfied with it, you might abort the process, delete the new version, and keep the old one. But if you don't use it, this zero downtime update, right now you are left with the new version. And actually bringing back to previous state is a feature we might add in future, because right now we also have the support from the cloud controller and runtime. Because you might, at one point of time, you might have two versions or contents of your application at the controller side. OK. Anything else? OK. What is the tooling? Okay, first of all, we have an integrated web IDE. So there you have this assistance for creating the MTA app, adding different modules for it, and you have very good assistance for compiling this this descriptor. Then you have also an automatic build to not just simple JAR file or a Maven plugin for actually building this thing if you want to package it. And actually something in that direction we might also bring in the open source world, because right now we are open sourcing the model plus the deployment with this not so, I would say, convenient way for building. It is not that complex, but you have to do some Maven configuration to build if you want to. For what? For building or of the MTA? Yeah, actually what we defined is the structure. We expect a container following the JAR spec, so you might use Gradle as well, or whatever, you might compile Bash. Okay. Okay, so thank you. I would be very happy to look on the Git repos and give any feedback. Thanks.